Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern joins us now from the Beehive. Mōrena, Prime Minister, or as contestants at the Chase referred to you last week, Jacinda Ardern. Would you have given them
Which
the point,
be
Prime
the first
Minister?
Time. Oh, absolutely.
It was a brilliant moment in pop culture, and not the first time you've appeared on the Chase either. Hey, thank you so much for joining us. Let's get to Three Waters. This is I'm still getting my head around this entrenchment issue. So I just wanted to go through it step by step. Did you know that this entrenchment clause had been added to the Three Waters legislation to protect our water assets from privatisation? Did you know that?
So just coming a step back, as I've already said, there was a general conversation around the principle of an entrenchment clause. Again here, entrenchment though, and Maddie, this is the important point, and maybe if I just give, because it is quite a complicated issue, this only applied to one part of the bill. So the proposal that a lot of people have been discussing, it sounds like it's about everything. It's not. It was just about whether or not you should be able to sell water assets.
Yes.
Now, Labor and the Greens obviously strongly opposed to the idea of water assets ever being sold or privatised. So in principle, that issue we were in support of. The separate issue is, how then do you protect that? And so there's this idea, this issue of entrenchment, the idea that you have to read a certain threshold of votes before something can be changed. Entrenchment's commonly understood to be 75%, a supermajority. And so I've indicated that there was a discussion at caucus, but I've also indicated that generally it's understood entrenchment to be 75%. I've not gone into further detail than that because, of course, what we discuss in caucus, generally we don't discuss outside of caucus, so I've given quite a bit more information than usual. The important point here is that whilst we supported the idea of protecting assets from being sold, entrenchment is a very special provision. We accept a mistake here has been made for it to be used in this way and dropped to 60. So we're going to fix that problem this week in the House, and we can do so quite quickly. After that, let's put in some guardrails so we protect against this happening again.
So why was that mistake made in the first place? We spoke to a constitutional law expert earlier on in the show who said entrenchment like this should only be used to protect things that are in terms of the democratic process of our parliament, not political issues like the privatisation of our water.
Yeah, so obviously a couple of things for us to pick through there. So, yeah, I think it's a fair point to say, how do we protect in the future from entrenchment provisions being used in areas that would be considered novel and a situation where, for instance, it can be at any point, not what is commonly understood to be the 75% mark? Well, the way that this happened on this occasion, it was through an amendment to the bill. Any party can do that. But ultimately, I don't think it's fair to say that somehow that makes it the fault of the party who put it forward. There are no general rules at this stage that say where you can and can't use entrenchment provisions. So our view is, actually, all parties in Parliament, it'd be worth us coming together, working through what we think in the future the parameters should be for using entrenchment, and bring in some of our experts as well. So I think that will be a positive outcome of this debate.
So this was discussed at caucus then, because there seemed to be an insinuation from you last week that this was something that was snuck in without your understanding or knowledge or consent.
No, I spoke last week about the fact that it was when I was asked. So no, I think again though, I've stuck very much to talking about the way that entrenchment is generally understood to be a super majority, i.e. 75%. What was voted on was 60% again. Not going to get into the nitty-gritty of it because we've accepted it's a mistake, Maddie, and we're fixing it.
It's a mistake, though, in a proposal that has been very contentious. Three Waters has not gone the way that you would hope it has gone. And has this just damaged the credibility of the legislation even further?
I think actually if you said to people, do you think water assets should be privatised, most people would say no. So I think there's agreement on that issue. What we have here is a very specific provision. Again, it's engaged a number of people from who specialise in constitutional law. So we've got something where actually the principle or the intent was understandable. but the mechanism that was used was problematic, and so that's what we're looking to fix.
That's not the question I was asking, though. The question is Three Waters, which on the face of it should have been a reasonably easy sell, you know, strengthening this basic necessity in terms of water, something that has been woefully underfunded for decades. You've lost people along the way somehow with Three Waters, and this doesn't do anything to strengthen that.
Maddie, I think you've actually made a fair point there. It should have been. Unfortunately, in some of the debate that's been had, in some cases we actually haven't even been debating what has been proposed by Three Waters. You know, it has been a difficult debate. Should it have been a difficult one? Well, in your view, you've said that you don't believe it should have been, and perhaps in our view it shouldn't have been either. But you know what I come back to? It is still, through all of that, having just come from a town this week where I was staying that is boiling its water and has been for the better part of a week, where the residents couldn't shower for days or wash their clothes, and as far as I understand, are still boiling their water because of water infrastructure issues, we have to do something. And ultimately, I couldn't stand by and be given information.
But then you make mistakes like adding this entrenchment thing in there, which doesn't do anything to win people back to your side, to your argument.
Again, Maddie, we've traversed that issue. The issue of privatisation, I will stand by. We don't want those assets privatised. Equally, this has been such a fraught area that, you know, you equally probably would have had people coming out if we'd voted against something like that and claiming that we wanted them privatised. It has been a very difficult debate because there's been people with very strong views on all sides, but I stand by what this bill is doing, which is to save people money and make sure that we have decent water infrastructure.
All right, let's talk COVID now. COVID case numbers seem to be trickling up. There's a bunch of new sub-variants in there. We're getting closer to Christmas, where a lot of people will be travelling and there'll be big gatherings. Are you concerned?
Oh, look, you know, what we're seeing is not necessarily unexpected. We did predict that we would continue as we had variants coming through. And as you saw, reinfection, and you'll likely know, and others will likely know, people who are at the stage now where they're getting COVID for a second time. That does not mean we are complacent. We are still amongst a relatively narrow group of countries who continue to require isolation for people who have COVID. Of course, we still make testing readily available, and we still encourage people to be boosted to protect themselves. So I still get through the numbers on COVID. We still keep a very close eye on everything. We keep an eye on our hospitalizations. There's not a complacency, but there's also a view that what we have at the moment, we are able to manage within the rules that we have.
Are our restrictions, on the flip side, are our restrictions still fit for purpose? I use myself as a case here, Prime Minister. I only got out of isolation yesterday after testing positive. I only tested positive because my partner had. I had no symptoms at all last week. I tested negative on Thursday, and yet the rules still stipulated I needed to spend another 3 or 4 days in isolation. So are our restrictions still fit for purpose, or does there need to be a sense, you know, a common sense approach to dealing with people who are getting COVID for a second time, for example?
Look, our rules are still fit for purpose. The number of people getting reinfections is still lower than the number of people who are getting their first infection. And ultimately, the rules, Maddie, are all based around the most, you know, the most common, the easiest way to reduce down your case numbers is to make sure people who have COVID stay at home. So that's the simple equation. And so we do still want to keep our case numbers down. We do still want to make sure that those who are vulnerable or immunocompromised at least know that we don't have a policy where if you have COVID, you're out and about. It is about making sure that we have those simple basic measures. And at this stage, having people with COVID at home is one of them.
Prime Minister, thank you so much for being with us this morning. That's Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern joining us from the Beehive this morning.